Hi, I'm Nan Simonson, and I am working with a group, our group who meets on Zoom every week for our PowerPoints, the points of interest as it relates to lifestyle as medicine. Some of you know that I also am in a training program, a 3-month practicum for health coaches, those of us who have already been through coaching. To and it's called coaching intensive practicum because it's a psychology course and it's very intense. And I'm learning as I, well, let me say, I'm learning a lot. And as I'm learning, I'm sharing things in different ways. And it's great to have this group as a way to talk about these things that relate to who and what we are, because our psychology has a lot to do with who and what we are. So I'll explain that term. The positive psychology was coined by a Dr. Martin Seligman, a lead researcher in psychology. After years in practice and believing that perhaps what was the norm was going about it the wrong way, and what was the norm was to find what was wrong with a person, label what was wrong, and then try to fix that. And there were certain degrees of success with that, but he found that he saw a greater success when working a different way in positive psychology. And I'll start reading from my notes. Positive psychology is one way that we are being taught as health coaches to focus on the strengths of people, the positive aspects of what they do well enough to be able to unfurl, let's say, challenges that are in front of them, rather than feeling that they're broken and have to be fixed. Because sometimes when people are broken, they simply play, they're labeled broken. They simply play that out. We tend to become what we think about, bring about what we think about, and by bringing about the negative, some people become entrenched in it, and by bringing about the positive, some people feel their strength and rise up to the occasion. So, applying positive psychology in your life focuses on enhancing your well-being, fostering positive emotions, and building up your strengths. Here are 10 ideas for integrating positive psychology into your daily routine. And before I get into those 10, as a whole food, plant-based health and wellness coach. And I talk all the time about my book, Aging Powerfully, which I wrote when I was about to turn 70, had already been a couple of years a health coach with a lifestyle medical practice, and learned that lifestyle as medicine, instead of medicine in many cases, can bring about stellar health that we can count on for decades. Eventually, something is going to wear us out and bring us down as we age, but that we could add years and years and years to life. And a number of studies, massive numbers of studies, have shown that that is the case. And in the College of Lifestyle Medicine, the doctor I work with and for is a founder of the College of Lifestyle Medicine. There are pillars of health. And I'm bringing all of this up because I can't go into positive psychology without reminding and teaching those who hear that we can affect our mind and body and our neurotransmitters, meaning our moods, to a great degree using the pillars of health, those pillars being nutrition. And in the College of Lifestyle Medicine, we promote whole food, plant-based eating. It can be plant-directed, it could be plant-based, it can be plant-exclusive, I have been going on 6 years now, plant exclusive. I feel like I've aged backwards that way from a relatively sick person almost 6 years ago to stellar health at 73 because of what I eat. When someone says, "Oh, you look so good," or "You're so energetic," or you look younger than your years, it's the food. It's the food and the pillars. So whole food, plant-based, plant strong, plant directed, at least plant cognizant is one way to go. Another pillar is movement. We must move our bodies and move them vigorously for a while every day. Even if it's calisthenics, we do something to get things moving, including our lymphatic system. And the guidelines, many of you have heard this, you're tired of it, are at least 150 minutes a week. And that's only what, 20, 30 minutes a day. That can be a walk after dinner. That can be three walks, one after every meal for 10 minutes. But movement is important. And prioritizing sleep, 7 to 9 hours a day. Prioritizing means that we don't just sleep when we happen to run out of other things to do and set an alarm so that we can get up very early and get to other things that we need to do. Prioritizing means I go to bed early enough that allows me to get my 7 to 9 hours. I like 8. I like, as a matter of fact, I tend to hit 8 on the dot with few or rare occasions without an alarm going off. It's to bed by 9:30 or 10, but lights out by 10 or 10:15, and then sleeping until about 6, and that's 8 hours. Prioritize sleep and stress management. And you're going to hear some of this, but these are the pillars of lifestyle medicine and community. Believe it or not, the people you hang with will influence the way you live your life, but also just hanging with people. Just connecting with people. If you've read Love 2.0, just micro moments of connection with people that leave you feeling enriched, even if it's for moments, meeting a person you may never see again. Those things make us healthier. They make us happier. They lower our cortisol. So the pillars of health are, let's say, primary to our health and our way of thinking overall. And then let's get even more specific about positive psychology. Practice gratitude, and you're going to hear many things that you hear me say relating to a number of different antidotes to lifestyle challenges or to life challenges. There will be similarities because these things come down to just being not only practical, but necessary. So practice gratitude. Each day, write down or mentally note things that you're grateful for. Why not aim for 3 or 4 or 5 every day? This practice can shift your focus from what's lacking to what's abundant in life. And positive psychology, remember, is focusing on what's working as opposed to what's not. Two, cultivate optimism. Work on seeing the glass half full. Work on it. If we look at a thing and immediately look at it poorly, be conscious of that and reframe what you've just thought or what you've just, the way you've seen it, and look for something about it that you find to be energizing or enlightening or maybe a way of embracing what you otherwise perhaps would have criticized. Again, work on seeing the glass half full. When faced with challenges, try to identify a positive aspect or an opportunity for growth. Love that. An opportunity for growth rather than something to be shunned. This doesn't mean ignoring negative, but rather balancing your perspective. Number three, savor positive experiences. Take time to fully enjoy positive moments and experiences. This could be as simple as enjoying a cup of coffee or tea, a warm bath, a beautiful sunset, a hummingbird. It's funny, I just saw this, a hummingbird hovering around the fountain. catching the drops that bounce off of it. I loved that. Taking a moment to look at that and emotionally embrace it. Try to be fully present and immerse yourself in the pleasure of these moments. Number four, strengthen relationships. Strong social connections are key to happiness. Make an effort to spend quality time with your family and friends. Show appreciation and offer support when it's needed. Creating positive relationships can provide a strong buffer against stress. Number five, create and pursue goals. Goals give life direction and purpose. Set goals that are challenging and yet achievable and align with your values. Celebrate your progress along the way to stay motivated, and then celebrate the end of the achievement with a new one that is being taken on. Not things that make us feel acceptable because we can do one thing after another. That's not what I mean. I mean something that we can feel so energized by that it sort of lights us up from the inside. Develop coping strategies. Life comes with ups and downs. Prioritize sleep. I'd mentioned that. Develop healthy coping strategies such as mindfulness, deep breathing, or talking to a friend can help manage stress and bounce back and help you bounce back from adversity. Things as easy as deep breaths can calm you down. One of the most effective, actually, according to Dr. Andrew Huberman, a neurobiologist and ophthalmologist, teacher, and the head of the Huberman Lab at Stanford University, says that the most calming thing that we can do on our own with our body, we can do with our breath, and it's something called a physiological sigh. You've probably heard me talk about this because I do it all the time, and I do it for exactly that reason. When we are either stressed or tired or not at our best, we quite often breathe shallow, have shallow breaths, and we can build up carbon monoxide in us, or carbon dioxide in us. Monoxide would be pretty bad, but dioxide's not that much better because our body wants a good balance between oxygen and carbon dioxide, and we need to off-put it. And the physiological sigh our body will do by on its own. Have you ever cried or watched a kid cry? And they're kind of running out of air because they're way too engaged in that crying, and they'll go, that's a physiological sigh. That's one word for what has been done, what it's done, the breathing in, and then a capping it off. It puffs up the alveoli in our lungs, the little sacs that can become depleted of oxygen, and then push it out. By doing a physiological sigh, one or even two, or maybe even three, if it doesn't make you lightheaded, but it usually won't, you bring back a balance of oxygen, carbon dioxide, and a calmness. When you breathe out longer than your in breath, that exhalation actually slightly slows down the heart. And so it really does physiologically do a number of things that calm us. So develop coping strategies, keep them up your sleeve, and pull them out when you need them. Seven, engage in kindness. Acts of kindness, whether big or small, can boost your mood and well-being. Consider volunteering, helping a neighbor, or simply offering a compliment. That's fun to do. Catching someone doing something right. Okay, an example. I was at the store, Trader Joe's, down the street, and I love being there to pick things up. And a woman had the most interesting, and I'll just use that word, interesting outfit. It was St. Patty's Day, and she had on just multicolor shoes. She had on a diamond pattern green and yellow skirt. She had on a flowered green and pink and yellow sweater. It was just a, it was a, I was going to say cacophony. I'll say that. And to a degree, it was a cacophony, but it was fascinating the way she pulled that all together, the way she stood there with, call it power and confidence, her pretty red lipstick. And she was standing there like she owned the place. And I couldn't help but say to her, "You look terrific. I love what you've put together. Your outfit is fabulous." And I meant every word of it. It felt good to say what I was thinking. How many of us think a thing, or maybe even think a negative thing, and then reframe it, turn it into a positive thing, and let it out. Let it out. It makes people feel really good, but I think it makes us feel just as good. Find a flow. I was reading recently about the concept of flow. Some people say that's not really a thing. Find your flow, get in a flow. Those of us who have, well, I'll say it, ADHD, clinically, we get into flow, and they call it hyperfocus. But all of us can get in a flow, and this is what I mean. Create and do activities that challenge you and engage your skills fully, so fully, such as hobbies and sports and creative pursuits, that it leads us to a state where we lose track of time because we're so engaged in the task at hand. Has that happened to you? You forget to eat. You forget to do what we're supposed to do all day long. That's an apple and green tea mixture, a spicy apple, one bag, a green tea, the other, that I throw in a big thing at night, and then whoops, and then sip it all day long. When you are, well, gardening. Lately, I'm pulling my garden together because it's going to be on a citywide garden tour. Boy, it better look good. And I've gotten out there so entrenched in what I was doing that an hour or two would go by, and I thought, and this literally just did happen, and I was almost late for something, and I thought, I've been out here 20 minutes. No, it had been an hour and 45. And that's fun. That's flow. Find things that you like doing enough and flow once in a while. Nine, practice mindfulness, or practicing mindfulness, in other words, taking the time to cultivate it, can enhance your awareness of the present moment and help reduce stress. Try mindfulness meditation, yoga, or simply paying attention to your senses during everyday activities. And then 10, foster forgiveness. This is so big. Holding on to grudges can weigh you down. Working on forgiveness can lead to better mental and physical health. This doesn't mean forgetting or excusing harm, but rather letting go of the hold it has on you emotionally and on your emotional well-being. Sometimes we can reframe the way we look at a situation and just see it differently. And sometimes there's no way to see it differently. It was what it was, and it was, well, in some cases, inexcusable. But what good does holding on to that do us? None. I hope this was helpful. Positive psychology. Look into Dr. Martin Seligman. Look into positive psychology. I was leading a group this morning, and one of the members takes courses for free from coursers.org. The word course, C-O-U-R-S-E, no, Coursera, Coursera.org, Coursera.org. And Dr. Seligman has a class there, or there's it's either a course or information about him, and it's free. And the more we know about finding equanimity, peace, joy, the best in ourselves, not the worst in ourselves, the better and the best we become. It's true. Hope you're having a great day. I know I'm going to. And I hope to see you again soon. If you're interested in knowing more about our PowerPoints group, it's a Zoom group that meets every Tuesday at 1:30 Pacific time. I'm in Southern California. You can write me at agingpowerfullywithnan@gmail.com. agingpowerfullywithnan@gmail.com. And we can get you hooked up. Have a great day. Bye. There we go.